Hey everybody, Joey here again, and welcome back. As you can see, I have in front of me a coffee table aquarium. Very interesting item to have in your home. I built this one myself, and I'm going to show you exactly how to do it. Now this coffee table aquarium is just my rendition of how I would like that one to be, including the top, the stand, lighting, filtration, and that sort of thing. You don't have to make the same aquarium in the same fashion, but it'll give you an idea of how they're made and how I made mine. Anyways, let's take a closer look at it.
Okay, so step one. Once you get your acrylic home, put everything together and make sure that everything fits together properly. You want to make sure that all edges and that sort of thing are lined up perfectly. Now your actual acrylic top, it has a 2-inch lip all the way around. Gives it more of a coffee table look. Now if you didn't have this and it was simply lined up with the tank, it would just simply look like a fish tank and on the floor in your living room. So that's why I do the 2-inch lip all the way around. So now that I know that everything fits together properly and everything lines up and it basically looks the way I want it to look, I'm going to go ahead and start to route the acrylic. Now basically I need to cut out a piece of acrylic here all the way to the end. I need to do that for every side. The reason being is because I need water to be able to evaporate and oxygen to get into the tank. The main reason why we cut such a big hole is so water does not condensate on the top. You want that to be crystal clear. If you only put a couple of small holes here, you're going to get a lot of condensation on here, meaning you're not even going to be able to see through. It's just going to be covered in water. Now, how big of a hole? Between 1 to 2 inches. I'm going to be doing like approximately about 1/2 inch all the way. And that will be on all corners. On all sides. This will also allow me for equipment cords to come out and that sort of thing as well. Anyways, that's one of the main things you need to have done. That's actually the second step. So I'm going to show you that now. Okay, so I need to make this piece of acrylic, which is a side, look just like this piece. The top cut out. That's basically what I'm doing for every piece. Okay? And in order to do that, I've got my router bit there. And this guide. Now basically all I'm going to do is lock this blade in place. I'm just going to use some vice grip to hold it there and push it into the router bit. This will start coming down about 1.5 inches. I've set my guide here at the back to 1.5 inches. From there, I'm going to remove this and slide it over to the next one. The other side will already be done as well. So basically, I'm going to cut this all the way down, and then again, all the way down. Then I'm going to come back here and push it over to the side and cut out that piece. So I'm going to do that right now. Okay, so everything's in place. Again, I'm pushing this down, cutting it down, and then we'll do the other side and then across. So here we go. We're going to turn the router on and let it get to its highest RPM. That's when we'll start pushing it in. Notice that once I got to the end, I shut the router off, but I did not move the acrylic. Keep it still until the router stops. So that's it there. Now, we keep this in place. We want this side to be identical, so we just flip it over.
Jason, on that side's done. Again, we removed this, and we're gonna go sideways now. Now the router itself is spinning this way. So you wanna go with the blade. The blade is going to spin counterclockwise. See here? And we want it to cut this way. We don't go this way, we're gonna come this way. We get it in place, put the guard down, turn it on, and then just push it over. There you have it. Now these two should match up. And they do. Repeat that for all of the panels. Next is rounding off the edges. This is going to be done by using the router again and with a corner round router bit. There you have it. That's what it's going to look like when you're done there, is it just rounded off the edge. This will be exposed, so that's how you do that. Next step is preparing the edges of the acrylic that is to be cemented to each other. Using an acrylic scraping tool, basically all we're going to do is put the acrylic scraping tool on approximately a 45 degree angle and scrape the acrylic until the saw marks are gone. Doesn't take much effort to get rid of them, but once you do that a few times, you'll notice that the scraping where we scraped here, there are no saw marks there. And then where we didn't scrape, if you can see that, there are saw marks. So that's important to do. One of the most important steps to building it. Anyways, we'll move on to the next step here now that we've scraped our edges. I'll continue to scrape the rest and then I'll show you the next step. Okay, next step, once all of your acrylic is cut, you can go ahead and put it all together.
Now you can have a look at my How to Build an Acrylic Aquarium series. That'll be on my channel. So go ahead and check that out and you will find out exactly how to assemble all of this acrylic. You'll in fact find out how to start to finish all the tools required and how to do everything in that series when you're building an acrylic aquarium. Anyways, I'm going to go ahead and get this together and I'll show you the next step. Okay, so now the tank is together. Obviously I went ahead and used the weld-on Forgan and the applicator bottle. So to find out and see how I cemented the tank together, you can go ahead and watch the How to Build an Acrylic Aquarium series and it'll show you exactly how to do it step by step. So right now, now that everything's put together and the edges are rounded both here and I did actually up the top part of it, I'm now going to install the braces, basically what's going to keep this lid in place. Now the idea I've come up with is to use acrylic blocks. Now they're basically going to go on each corner like so, but underneath it obviously, so then the top cannot slide around or be pushed off. The only way to get it off would be to lift the lid up. So I'm going to go ahead and do that now and I'll show you that step. Okay, so what I've done here is flip the lid over and I've matched the squares up with approximately where they'll go. So what's going to happen is I'm going to use Weld-On 16 because it's a thicker cement, and since I'm cementing over such a wide area, the thicker cement is a better cement for it, because it's not going to give me any bubbles or anything like that under it like the Weld-On 16 might. So that's basically it. I'm going to cement each guide into place. Once it's dried, I can go ahead and flip the lid over and it'll hold itself in place. So I'm going to do that now. Okay, so those are now in place. As you can see, they line up and do not let the lid fall off, whether you push it to the left or back and forth. It doesn't matter how you slide it. It still does have a little bit of give each way, but not a whole lot. Anyways, next thing I'm going to do is flame polish the edges. As you can see, it's still a matted edge. I want it to be nice and clear. I'm going to do every exposed edge that you can see. Okay, so like always, I'm just using a propane torch with a pencil tip. Now what I'm going to do is run it along this seam here so you can see exactly what it actually does. So I'm just going to go do that now. I'm just going to get a good look here. That's nice and slow. Now, you can tell the difference here. Flame polished edge and not flame polished. Now I'm going to go ahead and do the rest. Okay, so flame polishing is done. As you can see, what used to be a matted color is now glossy. Looks a lot better. So if you were to look on one glued edge, both edges are shiny now as opposed to one being matted and the other being shiny, so it looks more better. Okay, so that's the tank itself pretty much. Even the blocks were flame polished, everything was. So now we'll go ahead and go on to the stand, or at least the base of the tank, which is the table is going to sit on to help elevate it a little bit and to hide the equipment.
Okay, so here is the platform or stand for the aquarium. As you can tell, it's just a very basic and very simple stand. Now, it does need another coat of paint and a little bit more retouching, but this is basically what I'm going to be ending up with. Now, how I made this was just with a couple of pine planks and some 2x4s. If you can see in there, all it is a 2x4 framing and then the planks on the side. They're just screwed into place. I also then took some wood fill and filled in any cracks and sanded those down, rounded off the edges, that sort of thing. And also made sure everything was flat so that the aquarium can simply sit directly on top of it. So this is basically it. Now I did drill a couple of holes over here just for the lighting system, which I'm going to show you next. Okay, so here's what I'm going to be doing for lighting. It's just a basic old fluorescent light canopy that I'm no longer using. Essentially, all I did was remove the screws from the blast, and it came out. Now this fluorescent light has a switch on it, which is great. I'm going to be incorporating that into the stand itself. Now, how this is going to work is I'll take the stand, and as you can see, the inside is cut out. Well, not necessarily cut out, but left void. Basically, all I'll do is flip this over. I'm going to install the light pretty much just like that there. Okay, and then the on-off switch, as well as the power cord, is going to come through the two holes I showed you over here. This isn't exactly the positioning of everything, but this is how it's going to be placed in. So I'm going to do that now and show you what happens. Okay, so the lighting is now installed. As you can see, the switch and the power cord are over here. On and off switch. See in, the bulb is all the way to the bottom there. So there's all the wiring and the actual blast. Now I'm no electrician, but I basically just took the blast out of the light and put it into here exactly as how it came out. There were four plugs over here. I just plugged them back into where I took them out. And that was basically it. I'm just going to give you a closer look at the actual switch here. You see that? Oh. There it is there, on and off switch. Now that the lighting is good to go, just takes a moment to warm up here. Now that it's good to go, all I have left is to do some finishing touches to it, clean it up a bit, another coat of paint, maybe sand it, that sort of thing. But now we're going to move on to installing the tank on it. Okay, so the stand is now in place. First thing I'm going to do is put the actual tank on top of the stand. And just line it up. Doesn't have to be exact right now. Okay, so as you can see, there's lots of overhang here and on the sides. This is pretty much only possible because I'm using a half-inch acrylic bottom. If I were to use a thinner sheet for this aquarium, I wouldn't be able to do this. I thought it looked good. It's not going to be to everybody's taste, but I kind of like the overhang and that sort of thing. Originally, my idea was to not place anything in the tank whatsoever for decorations, and it would look good overhung like that. But I'm not the only one that gets a say about things that go around the house, so the fiance wanted to pick up some sort of a gravel or something like that, so I said it would have to be see-through, so glass beads would be probably best. So we came up with these. She picked this color. They're actually like a blue-green
She had a fancy name for this color, but they're just blue-green to me. So anyways, got enough just to cover the bottom. That sounds horrible, but I'm not scratching the acrylic. They're too smooth to scratch the acrylic. Next, I'm going to put the top on the tank. That's pretty much it. Now all I have to do is install filtration, fill the tank up with water, and put a fish in it. I'm going to use a cycled filter, so I'll be able to add the fish almost immediately. Maybe we'll go ahead and turn the lights on here. So it looks pretty good. Once there's water in it, it'll look much better. Just gonna see what it looks like without the lights on.
There, that's a much better look at it. Like I said, once there's water in it, it'll look a lot better. Okay, so now we're going to move on to filtration. Okay, so we're now on to the filter. Here you can see basically an acrylic box. What I've done with this here is use some scrap acrylic that I had kicking around, so it's not that nice or nice looking. I'm going to clean it up a bit. But basically the way this works, as you can see, is the top is a closed box with a strip of acrylic running the entire inside. The way this works is water enters through the small slit at the bottom, travels along and up into the chamber where the media will be. Now this is going to be a fluidized filter. Basically what will happen is water flows in, there will be an air stone through this hole right here. Just an airline releasing air into the chamber. The media will fluidize and will exit at the top, the air bubbles. So this will create some surface movement as well, which will aid in gas exchange. So setting this up, we need a pre-filter or mechanical filter. That's really simple. I just got a little sponge here and it fits nice and snug into this little slot. Just like that. Just like that. So water has to flow through here, but first it gets filtered out mechanically. All the particles and little floating items you might see in the tank. Finally, up through the chamber where the K1 Caldness media will be. Now that media is this here. Now putting that in, there's no way to put it in except for through the slit here. As you can see, it goes in. Now, I'll put the rest in once the filter's ready to go in the tank, but that's just an idea how it's all going to go in there. Now to clean that media, you don't ever have to take it out. K1 Caldness media is self-cleaning. I never have to clean that. I only have to clean this little sponge, which I just pull out, rinse in fresh water, and put it back in. I'm not counting on this to be biological in any form. It's just mechanical. My biological will be inside the box. So all I need is an air hose. Air hose connects to the back, like I was saying. Just through a little hole, big enough just so that the air hose tightly fits in. So I cannot, I can't take the actual air hose out unless I yank on it. But anyways, that goes in there, connects to a small air pump. The sponge goes on the side and that's it. And turn it on. You'll see it in operation here in a moment. So that's all I'm doing for filtration. It's portable, highly efficient, and self-maintenance, and very low maintenance, actually. And that's what I'm looking for in this tank, because it is just an aquarium for aesthetics. I'm not looking for it to be very practical or anything like that, but this allows me to keep it practical, efficient, and very low maintenance. Okay, so now we're gonna go ahead and put it into the tank. Okay, so installing the filter is actually pretty straightforward.
First, we want to get the air pump underneath. I've ran the air pump, which will be underneath of the stand, and only the airline tubing will come out through this hole. The light and the air pump are both connected to an extension cord that is beneath the tank, so only one cord is actually going to come from the tank. I can't avoid that. Now, before I install the air pump, you're going to want to install a check valve. Now, what a check valve is, this is only one type, it's a see-through type. What a check valve means is that air or water can flow up through it, but when the flow stops, the suction, there's no air or water that can suck back through. It's a one-way check valve. What that means is that when I'm pumping air into the tank, and it will be installed here, when air is pumping into the tank and the power goes out, if I didn't have this check valve in place, water could siphon out back out into the pump, ruin the pump, and probably flood the floor. I leave it long enough, I'll drain the entire tank. So a check valve is only a dollar or two and a definite must for anybody that uses an air pump. You gotta have them. Do not avoid it. Now, the way they install is simply cut your airline in half and slip it on, just like that. Now blow into the end which you believe the air is going to be pumping. Now I know air is going to be pumping this way, so I know that the airline goes in like that, black end facing towards the tank. Another aspect that I'm going to be implementing is two of these little suction cups. The reason being is because once this is in the tank, I don't want the airline flopping all around. I want it to be held snug to the ground so it cannot be seen. It's also very important to use clear tubing. If you're using black or blue, it's going to stand out a lot. Since it's running over the tank, which I'm probably not going to do it that way, it's probably going to come over the side of it, like so, it'll be much less visible. So, now I'm going to put the filter in the tank. As you can see, the filter is somewhat different than what you've seen only a moment ago. I've put a little piece of acrylic on the top of it. Basically, what this means is that the top of the tank, which is full acrylic, is not braced in the center. So that means I might eventually get some bowing. Now it's half inch acrylic, so I doubt that it'll bow, but just in case, it now rests on this. Now this little piece will have two functions. One, to stop the acrylic from bowing. Two, to hold the filter in place. Not that it needs to, but you never know. It might get bumped or knocked over, something like that, who knows. And this will be holding it in place. So now I'm just able to pick it up by this handle as well. Several functions of it, a little bit uglier than I wanted it to be, but I feel it's needed. So anyways, we'll go ahead and now get it into the tank. Okay, so the filter is installed. Tank is done. All I have to do now is fill it up with water and turn it on. Now notice that you don't see any cords or any hoses or anything like that in nature around the tank. The only thing I have is one power cord leading from the tank into the wall. It's unavoidable. Other than that, everything else is aesthetically pleasing. The only thing that I have in the tank that some might not like is the look of the filter being directly in the center of the tank. I do know that that is a bit of an eyesore, but I can tell you that once it's up and running, it actually looks pretty nice. And instead of the aquarium in itself being the conversation piece, a coffee table aquarium, you'll find that the filter in itself is more so the conversation piece, as it is extremely interesting once it's up and running. So all I gotta do now is turn the tank on, fill the tank up with water, then turn it on, and that's it. I'll add my fish because I've already have a cycled filter. I'm using cycled filter media, so my aquarium will be pretty much instantly cycled, so I can add fish right away. So I'm gonna go ahead and do that now, and we'll come back in just a moment. Okay, tank is filled with water now. Filter is installed. K1 Caldus is not 100% fluidized yet. Within a couple of weeks, probably 2 to 3 weeks though,
It should have enough bacteria on it to fluidize and fill the entire chamber. I'll do an updated video eventually on the entire setup, and you'll see it at that point that it is completely fluidized. Other than that, tank is done. I just have to release the fish that's floating there, and that'll be it. I'm going to give you some more views on it at nighttime as well as throughout the day, so you can get a good look at it. Okay, so here it is at night. As you can see, it's lit up quite well. It's really not this bright in person, though. But it gives you a good idea of what it looks like. Top view. Nice little view of the little fish you got in there.
So that's it. That's how I built my coffee table aquarium. Now, you'll notice that you may or may not have liked certain points of the video or certain aspects to this aquarium. One of them being the filter or perhaps the lip around the underside. These are just personal choices I've made. One thing you'll notice is the noise of the filter, the air bubbles rising. Now, I'm using a high definition camera, so it picks up the noises and amplifies them a lot more than is actually in person. If you don't like the noise and it's too loud for you, you can simply quiet it down by drilling more smaller holes. Other than that, the only thing I have coming out of the aquarium is one power cord that runs under the couch or love seat and plugs into the wall. Careful not to trip on that or pull on it. Other than that, everything is concealed. There's no wires, cords, or anything like that. I can see directly down into the tank and have a look at my fish. Now, of course, I only have a goldfish in here, and I know some of you guys might think that it's not a wise decision. To have a goldfish in here for life. Of course, it's not for life. You've seen some of my other tanks. You know I'm capable of keeping a fish until for its entire lifespan. If I don't have anything, I'll build it. Now, one thing you might notice is there's no heater in this tank. I could add a heater if I'd like, but one of the reasons I chose a goldfish is because he'll do fine at room temperature or ambient temperature, which should be fine. If not, the light heats the tank to a certain degree. Now, for ventilation within the tank, if the light gets too hot, which I don't plan on having on too often, I probably rarely ever have the light on. I'm only going to have it on for maybe an hour or two. Now, I've drilled some extra holes along the base of the stand in the back for ventilation of heat. Other than that, this tank is now complete. All I'm going to do is wait for the K1 Caldness media to completely cycle and make the filter look a little bit better. Other than that, it's done. That's how you build a coffee table aquarium, and that is actually just my take on it. You can build them however you like. Take a look at one of the other coffee table aquariums that are available to purchase, and you can probably replicate that idea. I've taken a little bit from here and there, seeing how they were done, and I thought I could do that. So I thought I'd give it a shot. While this is not a practical setup, it's definitely something nice to have. I don't plan on taking this tank too seriously in terms of stocking, but it's definitely a great conversation piece. Other than that, I do thank you for watching yet another one of my do-it-yourself videos. I hope you watch my future videos as well. If you're not a subscriber, please subscribe to me. Definitely helps me out tremendously. I do check out my subscribers' videos and watch them. I spend a lot of time doing that, actually. I like to see what they're doing. But anyways, thanks for watching, and I hope to see you next time. So that's it. That's how I built my coffee table aquarium. Now, you'll notice that you may or may not have liked certain points of the video or certain aspects to this aquarium. One of them being the filter or perhaps the lip around the underside. These are just personal choices I've made. One thing you'll notice is the noise of the filter, the air bubbles rising. Now, I'm using a high definition camera, so it picks up the noises and amplifies them a lot more than is actually in person. If you don't like the noise and it's too loud for you, you can simply quiet it down by drilling more smaller holes. Other than that, The only thing I have coming out of the aquarium is one power cord that runs under the couch or love seat and plugs into the wall. Careful not to trip on that or pull on it. Other than that, everything is concealed. There's no wires, cords, or anything like that. I can see directly down into the tank and have a look at my fish. Now, of course, I only have a goldfish in here, and I know some of you guys might think that it's not a wise decision, decision to have a goldfish in here for life. Of course, it's not for life. You've seen some of my other tanks. You know I'm capable of keeping a fish until for its entire lifespan. If I don't have anything, I'll build it. Now, one thing you might notice is there's no heater in this tank. I could add a heater if I'd like, but one of the reasons I chose a goldfish is because he'll do fine at room temperature or ambient temperature, which should be fine. If not, the light heats the tank to a certain degree. Now, for ventilation within the tank, if the light gets too hot, which I don't plan on having on too often, I probably rarely ever have the light on. I'm only going to have it on for maybe an hour or two. Now, I've drilled some extra holes along the base of the stand in the back for ventilation of heat. Other than that, this tank is now complete. All I'm going to do is wait for the K1 Caldness media to completely cycle and make the filter look a little bit better. Other than that, it's done. That's how you build a coffee table aquarium, and that is actually just my take on it. You can build them however you like. Take a look at one of the other coffee table aquariums that are available to purchase, and you can probably replicate that idea. I've taken a little bit from here and there, seeing how where they were done, and I thought, I could do that. So I thought I'd give it a shot. While this is not a practical setup, it's definitely something nice to have. I don't plan on taking this tank too seriously in terms of stocking, but it's definitely a great conversation piece. Other than that, I do thank you for watching yet another one of my do-it-yourself videos. I hope you watch my future videos as well. If you're not a subscriber, please subscribe to me. Definitely helps me out tremendously. I do check out my subscribers' videos and watch them. I spend a lot of time doing that, actually. I like to see what they're doing. But anyways, thanks for watching, and I hope to see you next time.